Hello friends, Mandar here. I'm back with another video. Today we are going to talk about how are the visa numbers used, especially in the EB category, employment based category. There are two types of spillovers, the spillovers that happen within the category, that is within the employment based category, as well as the spillovers that happen from family based category to employment based category. So I'm going to tell you how these visa numbers are allocated based on the statute as well as what Charlie has told us. I'm also going to go through some of the popular questions that I'm getting on my channel. So watch this video until the end and let's get started. If you are here for the first time, welcome. My name is Mandar and I make immigration related videos for US and Canada. I'm not an immigration lawyer, so anything that I say on this video or on my channel is for information purpose only. And for your specific immigration needs, before taking any action, you should hire a competent immigration lawyer. Now, there are a lot of questions on my channel regarding how are the spillover visa numbers used. So basically, let's go through some of the basics. We know that there are 140,000 EB category visas every year. That's per the statute that hasn't changed for last several decades. So we have only 140,000 visas available across all countries for the employment-based category for a particular year. Similarly, there are 226,000 visa numbers available for family-based category, and those are spread across all the countries and for a certain year. In a typical year when there are no external factors such as pandemic or closures or things like that, typically these visa numbers are used in the employment-based category because there is a high demand. But in the family-based category, we sometimes see a small spillover from year to year, and those are available for the employment-based category as per the law. Recently, due to pandemic since last year, 2021 and 2022, we are seeing a lot of spillover, as you know, from family-based category to employment-based category. So basically, for the last year, FY 2021, which started in October of 2020, we have seen about 120,000 visas spilled over from FB category, which is family-based category, into the employment-based category. So these were in addition to 140,000, so that makes a total of 260,000 number of visas available for employment-based category for this current fiscal year, which is FY 2021. Now, as per Charlie's last interview, he is expecting to see 290,000 visas available for employment-based category in the next year, which starts on October 1st, 2021 and goes until September 30th of 2022. So there will be even more visa numbers available than they were available for this year, which means obviously everybody is excited that the priority dates are going to move even faster. Now, this effect will slow down, this pandemic effect. This was mainly caused due to closures of the consulates abroad because most of the family-based visas are given in the consulates that are outside of the United States. That trend might discontinue after 2022. We are already seeing the consulates reopening and starting to issue their family-based visas. So these spillovers might continue for another year or so, but it will taper down again. But let's look at what's happening. Now, coming back to the point, how are these visa numbers allocated? Now, as per the statute or as per the INA guidelines, which is Immigration and Nationality Act, there are certain percentage of visa numbers available within a category. So say for instance, first let's talk about the spillovers from EB category. So what does that mean? EB category has EB1, EB2, EB3, EB4 and EB5. So for the EB category, there are a total of 140,000 visas for a year. So not more than 28.6. So not more than 28.6% of visa can go to a particular subcategory, which is say for instance, EB1 will have 28.6%, EB2 will have 28.6% plus unused from EB1, and EB3 will have 28.6% plus unused from EB1 and EB2, and so on. So there is a percentage set for each subcategory. Now EB4 and EB5 have 7.1% worldwide. So this is the percentage split among 140,000. Now on top of that, there is another level of complexity, which is the per country cap. So now each country only gets 7% of visas in the first go around. So basically what happens is all of these 140,000 visas are split by 28.6% each and 7.1% each. And then there is another layer of 7.1% per country. So this is the first pass. So basically there is a certain, only certain set of visa numbers available for, say for instance, for India and for China, which is roughly around 8,000 to 9,000 visas. Now, after the first round is done, if there are unused visa numbers from EB1 category, they spill over to EB2 category. And if there are unused number from EB2 category, they spill over to EB3 category. But how are these unused numbers used? These number, unused numbers, are when they are spilled over to the next level, of, they go to the earliest priority date applicants. So say for instance, EB2 India has been backlogged to for several years to like 2010. So when there are spillover numbers coming from EB1, which is currently happening, those spillover numbers will go not to the ones that are current, say for instance 2011 June. They will go to the earliest priority date which is pending in that category. So even if there is a person waiting in EB category that is later, that has a later priority date, they will get the next in line preference because the first preference goes to the earlier priority date. That's what Charlie explained in one of the interviews. Now this was within the EB category of visa. Now let's look at what happens when there is FB category spillover into EB category. So in that situation, now we are saying that this year there were 120,000 visas available from FB category spilled over into EB category. Now these are again distributed by the same percentage that was set by the Congress, which is 28.6% per category, which is EB1, EB2, EB3, and then 7.1% for other categories. Now if there are any unused number for from any of these categories, they spill over to the next one, and the same logic applies. The spillover numbers always go to the earliest priority date, not the latest priority date. Now how this impacts in the reality, let's look at that. Say for instance, somebody had their priority date current in last October or November or December, and they applied for their 485 and they got their EAD and they are still pending. And somebody who has recently got their priority date current in EB2 category, say for instance in March or April, but their priority date was so long back, which could have been like 2010 priority date, whereas the person who applied for 485 in October or November, their priority date might have been in 2016 or 2017 in EB category, but they are still waiting because of the backlog. Now the spillover numbers, when they come over from EB1 to EB2 or EB2 to EB3, they go to the earliest priority date. So now what we are seeing is, even though some people had their priority date current, because their priority date was later than people who got their priority date current recently, are still waiting. So the people from October, November, December might still be waiting for their green cards, whereas people who got their priority dates current in as recent as April or May have already got their green card because their priority date was so earlier, if that makes sense. So that is one logic to look at. Now this trend has always been there. It's nothing new. It is just enhanced because of the number of applicants that have come into the pool of 485. Now that is the reason that we are seeing this disparity in terms of who gets their green card earlier than later. Everything else being equal, it's the priority date that matters. The earlier priority date that you have, and if you're in the same pool, the chance that you will get your green card sooner than the one who has the current priority date, but it's later than yours. Hope that makes sense. Now let's look at some of the common questions that I got on my channel. One of the most popular question is, what is your prediction for October of 2021? Now, as Charlie mentioned, that there will be 290,000 visas available, which is even more than what we saw this year. So my prediction is EB2 will advance by 2 to 3 years from the last date that we will see in August or September of this year. Say, for instance, for EB2, the filing dates is December 1st of 2011. So, and then the final action date is expected to reach that date of December 1st, 2011 by the end of September. So, in October, we could see another progression of 2 to 3 years for EB2. So, we are talking about 2013 or 2014 for EB2 in October visa bulletin. And that's just my guess at this time. It may change as we see August and September visa bulletin. For EB3, since the priority date is expected to reach 1st of February 2014 by September, I would see another 4 years of addition. So the EB3 priority dates might move to 2018 in the October visa bulletin. So this is just my prediction based on what we saw last year and based on what Charlie mentioned, the visa numbers available for the next year. As we get closer to August and September, this might get even more clearer, and I will be making another video specifically dedicated to the prediction for October visa bulletin. So subscribe to my channel if you haven't already, and stay tuned as I'll be making a specific video on October visa bulletin prediction in upcoming month. Now, I have even seen that some people are getting their medical request RA fees from USCIS even though their priority dates are not current in the final action date chart. This is interesting. This never used to happen, but I think Charlie and Department of States are moving the filing date chart much more in advance to create the demand. In the last interview, he did mention about this point, that they move these dates forward just to create demand, and so that they can anticipate what is the demand, and then they can adjust their final action dates as well accordingly. So there are instances where people have got RA fees for their 485 application to submit their medical even though their final action date is not current. So that is interesting, and the answer to that is they just want to churn up the demand, make people documentarily ready, so as soon as the priority date reaches, they will be able to assign a visa number and give out the green card as soon as possible. So I think the mandate for USCIS and State Department is to clear the backlog as early as possible, and that's what we are seeing in this year and next year. Some people are asking whether the priority dates will retrogress. As I said earlier, yes, they might retrograde, but not so soon. It might happen towards the later part of 2022. That is when all the consulates are expected to be fully operational back to their normal levels, where they start issuing their FB category visas, and we'll see smaller and smaller number of spillover visas coming into the EB category, and thus slowing down the process again. But that's still a little too far off. We don't want to talk about it yet. For now, let's bask in the good news of moving priority dates for the next several months. So that's all I wanted to say in this video. If you like the content of this video, please hit the like button and consider subscribing to my channel, and I'll see you in the next one.